Hello, everybody. Welcome to Rush Roundtable. We got another Red song for you. This is Red Sector A, the third song from Grace Under Pressure. I'm your host, Ryder. We're joined by a wonderful panel. We got Todd, Ryan, Rob, and David. Welcome you guys to the episode. It was a very interesting song on Grace Under Pressure, referencing the Holocaust and as a tribute that Neil wrote for Geddy Lee's parents, who were Holocaust survivors. So let's just get right into this. Ryan, would you read from the song by song?
I would be delighted to. Thank you. So
excellent.
Song by song. Red Sector A. The name of this song is completely ambiguous. In fact, it comes from the name of the area where the band watched the Columbia Space Shuttle launch in 1981. That site of such hope and optimism. This ambiguity, this meaningless clinical title, is part of the horror that this song about a nameless, timeless place evokes. Geddy Lee's mother was interned in the Nazi concentration camp at Bergen-Belsen until it was liberated by the forces of the UK and Canada in 1945. She had remarked to her son, who then relayed on to Peart, that she simply could not believe there was any civilization left. I once asked my mother her first thoughts upon being liberated. She didn't believe liberation was possible. She didn't believe that if there was a society outside the camp, how they could allow this to exist. So she believed society was done in. The song asks the question, are there any human beings to survive? A simple question with a complicated answer. Anyone listening to this song would be likely to surmise it was recorded in the early 80s. The synthesizers are brash and the song is more electronic than any other on the album. However, it remains a powerful song about the subject that is almost impossible to relate to without resorting to platitudes or cliche, neither of which are present here.
Thank you for reading. This is a very, very deep song on the album, obviously dealing with just the ideas of the Holocaust and things of genocide. And there's a lot of personal aspects to it too. And just as we discuss it, you'll start to see more and more of like the firsthand experience that was evident in the Holocaust. So let's just get started with this first section of lyrics with the intro. All that we can do is just survive. All that we can do to help ourselves is stay alive. So Rob, what do you think about the intro to this song?
Yeah, I went the cliche route. I thought it was like a science fiction type of tune, you know. I think like fairly close to this period of time the Terminator came out with Schwarzenegger. And yeah. I always had this sort of science fiction thing in my head, like, you know, they're on the planet and they're imprisoned by, you know, there's like robotic things flying through the air and all this sort of thing. I didn't really appreciate the historical part of the tune because I was so young at the time when it came out. I was like 12 or 13 when it came out. So I didn't really put it together. You know, further into the tune, the lyrics go a little bit further. And I just had this whole sci-fi thing in my head. So I didn't really have a specific idea of what the song was about, and I was really more into the music, so I didn't really appreciate that part of what the song is, you know, how deep it goes historically until much later.
Yeah, I was the same way. I thought it was like a science fiction thing about like some alien foreign prison. It wasn't until a little later on in like an interview or something that I heard that it was about the Holocaust. With this song, the instrumentation is definitely very different. Once again, another song on Grace Under Pressure without any bass. I think this song and After Image are the only two that don't have any recorded bass. If that's wrong, correct me in the comments down below. But yeah, this is a very synthesized, like almost like robotic and just like formulaic beat. Well, maybe not formulaic, but it's just like there's a rigid pattern almost, and it kind of makes you feel like there's marching going on in the camps or something like that. That's always how I've seen it, with just the straight quarter note bass thing that's going on, the bass pedals, Alex just driving it with super high chords, very crazy chords to open up the song and just carry it through. And Neil's just constantly driving the beat just the whole time, and he adds stuff on. It's a really, really cool bit of instrumentation. So moving on, this next section.
I just wanted to say one thing on that specific part. I think it's purposeful that that is repeated. It's sung twice, that part, because I look at it from the perspective of the prisoners, you know. those in the camps. Day over day, it's the only thing they know is survival, right? And I think it's repeated because that's literally what they're doing every day. It's just a constant repeat of service. So I think that was purposeful, that was repeated at the beginning.
I had one other point too, based on what Rob said. I never thought about this till just now, thinking that it was sci-fi before you knew that it was about an historical event. But a lot of old sci-fi, Ray Bradbury, Isaac Asimov, Walker Percy, were critiques of worlds that produce that kind of horror. So it really is sci-fi, I think, in some way, or, you know, certainly there's a connection there. I mean, to without knowing the history, to assume it's sci-fi, I think you're right on target there with what a lot of sci-fi does, and that's critique this kind of world.
Yeah, awesome observations. Moving forward, we have this next body of lyrics. Ragged lines of ragged gray, skeletons, they shuffle away. Shouting guards and smoking guns will cut down the unlucky ones. Very, very powerful set of lyrics right there. Todd, what are your thoughts on that section?
My thoughts on that is, for people that are in a prison camp, I would imagine that they can hear a lot, but I imagine that they probably can't necessarily see a lot, just images here and there. Mm-hmm. And so I think of that as being in a position of being very fearful, not knowing what the sounds are, like what, not knowing if the shouting guards means that they're coming for them. We'll cut down the unlucky ones. I think that means that there's an awareness that there are unlucky ones, and we might be one of them. And I think that it's just uncertainty of not knowing, you know, when you hear the guards shouting, does it mean they're coming for us, or does it mean the liberators are here? What does that mean? Ragged lines of ragged gray, I haven't really been able to figure out. I think it's a beautiful line, but I don't really, if anybody else has something on that one.
Yeah, I do have a thought on that. Probably the clothes they were wearing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Ragged,
yes.
And gray. And,
oh, yeah.
And of course, they're skeletons because they're not fed.
Yeah.
Right. And they may see them walking from one place to the other, and it just may look like a gray line.
Yeah. And then, you know, cut
down.
That's
great.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's how I take it.
Well, the shouting guards and smoking guns, well, first of all, smoking guns part, Clockwork Angels tour, fireworks, smoking guns. Remember that? Pretty awesome. Scared the crap out of me. I wasn't born, but yeah, scared the crap out of me when that happened. The first of three shows that I went to in that tour, but we'll cut down the unlucky ones, right? So I think Getty did a radio interview back. I don't know, maybe around the R40 tour, I can't remember, but it was recent in terms of or near the end of the Rush career, right? Where he said that, you know, his mother, or no, I think his grandmother lined up her kids in order so that.
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about? I'm,
yeah.
Words are not coming out of my mouth properly right now, but like,
I know what you mean.
They would pick one go this way, one go this way, one like, and they would split them, and the grandmother would organize them so that the whole family would stay together. So, you know, even numbers are their family, odd numbers are other people or whatever they would do, so that they were the lucky ones and not the unlucky ones that would be. You'd have to watch the interview to watch Getty describe it, but I think that's what is being talked about here.
Yeah, because a lot of the in Nazi concentration camps, they would randomly select people to just be killed. That's what that line was, and like making them ordered out. So it'd be like, okay, you guys can go over here and work. You guys go over here to die. That's what that was. And I say this a lot on Rush Roundtable, other than, hey guys, welcome to Rush Roundtable. Neil paints an image in your head might be my most said phrase, but this song does such a great, great job with the lyrics, just displaying that horror. And as obviously as people in this call, and I'm sure the viewers at home who didn't experience the Holocaust, it's crazy to be put in those shoes and to feel somewhat of that terror that they must have felt. It was really, you know, these terrifying images of skeletons shuffling away and smoking guns cutting down the unlucky ones. That was a day-to-day reality for those people. And it's just crazy to think how he interprets that through just the lyrics in the song. So moving forward, we have, I clutch the wire fence until my fingers bleed, a wound that will not heal, a heart that cannot feel, hoping that the horror will recede, hoping that tomorrow will all be freed. So this section of the song is, at least to me, it's just the desire to escape. Because you see, obviously, hoping that tomorrow will all be freed, but like, I clutch the wire fence until my fingers bleed. That, A, that's just my favorite line in the whole song, but B, it's just so powerful to just want to be out of there, and just like, a wound that will not heal, a heart that cannot feel. It's just being pretty much desensitized to all of this. You had an entire life that was stripped away from you completely unwillingly just because of who you were, and just praying and hoping that that was going to be the day that you would get out. It's truly a terrible, awful, awful thing. I'd never wish that upon anybody. And just the desire to get out of there so much that you're literally holding on to the walls that are holding you there until your hands start bleeding. It's just, it's terrifying. It's just absolutely just one of the most evil things in the world. It's just a lot right there in that one little section.
I think there, yeah. Is this the chorus? I mean, is this considered the chorus?
I would consider it the chorus, because when it comes back with the, I hear the sound of gunfire, it's just kind of that same motif.
I mean, I think that, so this, you could divide this into two sections, right? The, I clutch the wired fence till my fingers bleed, a wound that will not heal, a heart that cannot feel. That's the horrors, that describes the horrors of the day to day. But then the bottom section, you know, hoping that the horror will recede, hoping that tomorrow will all be freed. That's hope. Like, you, it describes the horror, and then it describes what these people are hoping for the outcome of this is. So I think it's interesting how it describes the horrors, but then it, you know, puts into perspective that you can do two things. You can try to survive, and you can hope, you know, while you're in concentration camp. So.
Mm-hmm. And that's like the one single thing, right? You know, it's not like, I hope that I'll get a promotion at my job. I hope I can listen to a few Rush records tomorrow, all the things we hope, wish, desire for. But put in this situation, there's only one thing. Everything else drops away.
Yeah.
And you hope for one thing, just to be free.
Yeah.
At the end, that's what we all want, right? Just to be free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So moving forward with this next section, sickness to insanity, prayer to profanity, days and weeks and months go by, don't feel the hunger, too weak to cry. So David, what do you think about that section?
You know, that third line, days and weeks and months go by, sort of defines, I think, that verse, because you go from a process, first you're just sick, but sickness to insanity, losing your mind. You start out with prayer, but then just to profanity, and all that. So just slipping away more and more as the days and weeks and months go by, and you get to the point you no longer feel the hunger and you're too weak to cry. I mean, at this point, it's, you know, the verse before that, hoping that tomorrow we'll all be freed. But now, you know, you're just, everything slipping away. Mm-hmm. You know, it's probably, to me, the darkest verse, or, you know, set of in the song. But then it, you know, I'm not going to get ahead, but then it comes back to, I hear the sound of gunfire. So, you know, maybe reinvigorating that hope. But that particular verse is just this progression of what happens over time when, you know, they were in those camps.
I really like the idea of this verse being that, like, descent into just that of everything, like, negative feelings wise. Especially the line that does stick out to me the most is prayer to profanity, because, you know, their religion and their heritage, that's what those people were mainly put in those concentration camps for, because they were Jewish. And, you know, like, you, in that kind of scenario, really all you could cling on to is faith. But eventually there becomes a point where you're in that scenario for long enough where faith just isn't doing it anymore. You start getting angry, you start getting rageful. I'm sure a lot of people have like their own religious frustrations, but in a time where like that was all they really had and then they begin to lose that, it's just gut-wrenching. That's really all I can say about it.
And it kind of speaks to language, right? Prayer, that's one kind of language. Mm-hmm. Profanity is another kind of language. It starts out in this kind of language and it moves to that kind of language. And it kind of echoes back to just the heart of the song is all that we can do, you know, just a day at a time, try to survive. And
I think there's an interview that Neil did with Jim Ladd, the DJ, and he's talking about how he was really moved by the fact that he says, I read that these people kept their little rituals of their religion. If it was supposed to be a fasting day, even if they were starving to death, they would turn down their little bit of bread and their little bit of gruel because it was a fasting day. They had to hold on to something. And that moved me. And so they probably started out doing that, those kinds of things. And then as days and weeks and months went by, they started feeling different things.
Wow. Yeah.
I think it's purposeful the way this is written. Days and weeks and months go by.
Yeah.
Usually it would be days, comma, weeks and like English. I wasn't an English major, but I know some English. But I think that's purposeful because it's like almost like a run-on sentence, and that's basically their experience.
Yeah.
It was. Mm-hmm. So I think it's just these very subtle things that Neil did with the writing, or maybe it was Getty tweaked it or whatever. But the way they wrote some of these lines in the song seemed totally intentional.
Just
super impressive because of it.
Yeah. For sure. So moving on to what I believe is the second chorus. I hear the sound of gunfire at the prison gate. Are the liberators here? Do I hope or do I fear? For my father and my brother, it's too late, but I must help my mother stand up straight. Are we the last ones left alive? Are we the only human beings to survive? So Ryan, in this last body of lyrics, what are your thoughts?
So this is from, I think this was, yeah, Neil talked about this in 2013. The line, for my father and my brother is too late, but I must help my mother stand up straight, refers to the practice of those living in World War II death camps to hold up the sick and the feeble when the guards came around to prevent them from being taken away and gassed, because it was the practice in the camps to immediately gas those who couldn't work. A memoir by another female survivor of Auschwitz filled in more details, like how if anyone appeared too ill or feeble to work, they would be sent straight to the gas chambers. So even in that dehumanized nightmare, people showed grace under pressure and tried to help each other appear healthy.
Yeah. So
that's kind of the story behind that specific lyric. You know, I must help my mother stand up straight. If your mother's ill or feeble, you're doing what you can to help her survive.
So. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which is, it's really great, even in that scenario that of the Holocaust and those concentration camps, that people are still willing to come together and help each other out, even if these people are absolute strangers. Like you read stories from the Holocaust of like, just people who've like people who just like met there and became really good friends and tight and tried to help each other out. You hear about that stuff all the time, but it was like actual things that really went on, that it was less about, well, there was still obviously like trying to keep yourself alive, but trying to help everybody else out that you could. Cause you know, everyone was in different states at that time. So in order to just like help save a life, if you could, you should have done that. So going after this, there's a guitar solo, which is incredible. It takes a step back from like some of the faster paced solos that you'd see on this record, like Kid Gloves, picks it up a little bit from the solo that was on After Image. but the way it just flows through and the use of harmonics in it, guitar players in this call and who's watching this video, you know exactly what I'm talking about. The way he just moves through the solo is just incredible. And it continues to bring through the emotional aspects of the song. Mm-hmm. I see the latter half of the solo almost being like that bit of hope shining through darkness.
Yep.
That's how I interpret it. I learned the solo recently, and that was the image I always had in my head when I was playing that latter half of the solo.
That's exactly what I was about to say. It's dark and it's hopeful. I was literally going to say the same thing. So well put.
Yeah.
Well put.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's got some of the same stuff as in some of the same technique as in the After Image solo, but it's a completely different feel. I mean, it's the same kind of combination between notes and chords, but the feel is completely different.
Yeah.
Very pianistic too. It's actually almost like if you could probably play that on keyboards too, not just guitar. So it's got a very keyboard vibe on it as well. You know, the little ding, little glissando things he does in there too.
Yeah.
The harmonics. So you can easily replicate that on keyboard. You can do the same thing there.
Mm-hmm. And even speaking about keyboards, in this section of the song, Getty really pulls it back and is mainly just offering just a little bit of like a synth bass line, just that octave. That's really all he's doing. And then he throws in some chords and stuff later in the solo and uses some pads to kind of just fill in the atmosphere. But it's just so cool how the interplay of all three musicians kind of come together, because that, I believe, is what really elevates it to that darkness and then hope status, is once they start coming in more prominently. And then everything shuts down, goes back into a more traditional feel for this song, and then ends on a repeat of that last section of lyrics. So, and this song ends really brilliantly. How it does, I mean, it repeats the same thing again, but just that ending where it just breaks it down a little bit more, less focused on the beat, and you start to get a little bit more Neil just floating around the kit and putting in little fills and stuff. But I think this song ends wonderfully. What do you guys think about the closing of this song?
Well, I was going to say something about that line, are the liberators here? Do I hope or do I feel? Do I fear? There is a radio interview that Getty did where he was talking about asking his mother how she felt on the day that she was liberated. And she told him that she didn't think liberation was possible, because if society still existed, they wouldn't have allowed this to happen. So society must just be toast. And that's not a quote, but that's kind of how she was she was feeling. And I think that's incredibly powerful. I mean, I can't even imagine thinking that.
As we were counting also on Dave Grohl's documentary From Cradle to Stage, the last episode in that series, which actually aired, and then I guess a month after that episode, Getty's mom passed away. But she actually talked about that very thing that you just mentioned, Todd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any additional closing thoughts on the song?
I think that last chord is like a major chord that he ends on.
Yes, it does end on a major chord, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So before we bring this episode to a close, let's discuss our favorite live versions of the song. There's a good couple of these. I'm pretty sure Grace Under Pressure, Show of Hands, Rush in Rio, and I think Clockwork Angels is the only other one. On R30, there is a version of it, but it's exclusive to the Blu-ray. So if you guys want to include that in yours, go for it. But let's just go through. Todd, what is your favorite live version?
I'm going with Clockwork Angels because of the explosion, which scared me. I didn't go to the show, but it scared me when I saw the Blu-ray and the strings. And the amazing thing about another amazing thing about that performance is that Alex is playing on at the beginning, and also his solo is so much like the recording. And to be so many years later, and for him to just, I mean, he's like that with a lot of things, but for some reason in that particular performance, it really struck me as, wow, he's on fire during his solo. He just sounds great. So yeah, that's my favorite.
Yeah.
There are a lot of good ones though. It was hard.
Yeah, it's really tricky because every single version of Red Sector 8 is something a little bit different, which I will touch on in mine. So my favorite version is actually the Grace Under Pressure live version, if you couldn't tell by my little thing from the intro from the beginning of that song and the live cut. But yeah, I just love it. It's super solid. I love the video for it because you can actually watch it on the Rush YouTube channel. And Stick Hits did a very, very good job of remastering it in 4K, I believe. Yeah, it's just a very, very good version of it. I love all the little extra fills Geddy Lee adds in. I will give an honorable mention, though, to the Russian Rio version. Because it does something a little bit different with the synthesizers. Instead of going into just like straight synth pads and stuff like that, Geddy instead, he uses more of like a traditional organ sound, which I think is pretty cool. It kind of gives the song a little bit of a different feel, but I still think the Grace Under Pressure version is my favorite. Ryan, what about yours?
So I'm looking on Setlist FM right now, and it looks like it was also played live on Test for Echo.
It tour, was, yes.
And the Power Windows tour. So that's pretty, I mean, obviously we don't have, neither one of those are documented. Well, I guess some of Test for Echo is, it's on YouTube, but I'll have to seek those out. But to answer the question, I'm with Todd, mainly because I saw it, I don't think it rotated on Clockwork Angels. I think it was every night. So
I'm
pretty
sure it was an every night one.
Yeah.
I was fortunately able to see that tour 3 times and poop my pants 3 times when those fireworks went off. But yeah, I mean, getting that late in their career, I mean, Geddy's voice, you know, obviously was starting to take a downhill turn, but I felt like even late in the show where Red Sector A was placed, if it wasn't thrown in with all the 80s stuff in set one, it was actually near the bottom with the, like you said, the string section. I thought Geddy sang it very well, all things considered. So, yeah, I would say the Clockwork Angels tour.
He did. I think that song is Geddy's strongest performance on that particular.
Yeah, I could see it.
For yeah, sure. I did a really good job with that section. Rob, what's your favorite version?
Yeah, Grace Under Pressure for me, for sure.
Nice. Very good.
No explanation. Just
no explanation.
That's it.
Right at that time, and it was so fresh and new and energetic. I just love the energy coming off of that. You know.
Yeah. If you guys haven't watched it, check out the live DVD for Grace Under Pressure live. I would say it's probably my favorite Rush live performance. I've watched that more times I can count. Yes. So good.
When I was
plus you can't beat it. You got to count Floyd.
Yeah. When I was in college, we wore out that VHS tape. I'm dating myself.
That's awesome. So right. Closing it out, David, what's your favorite live version?
Yeah, kind of tough, but I am going to go with Todd and Ryan on Clockwork Angels. I mean, I want to say Grace Under Pressure because, you know, I mean, I had the VHS tape and the explosion, of course, that we've talked about. I'm not sure I could, you know, I'd stand to be corrected on this. I'm not sure they did an explosion in other versions up until Clockwork Angels.
No, I think it was only those two.
Yeah. And so bringing that back in a lot stronger, you know, the poop your pants, you know, explosion.
that's what it will be referred to as now.
Henceforth. Yes. What was great, but also it seemed like, a really mature version of the song after playing it for so many years.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was just so rich. And I can't imagine, given, you know, the personal nature of the song, especially for Geddy, but, you know, also Alex, you know, his parents were in prison camps and things like that, to play that song so many times over the years. But it seemed just really mature on Clockwork Angels, I thought.
Yeah, I just realized with Ryan mentioning all the different tours it was played at that I've seen it a whole bunch of times. Mm-hmm. I sure wish I could have made some kind of recording in my memory so I could play it back.
500.
I wish I could have seen it.
501 times. 501, it says. Played.
Dang. Mm-hmm. There you go. Oh, awesome, guys. That was Red Sector A, the third song from Grace Under Pressure. What do you guys think of this track? Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell so you know when you got more episodes of Rush Roundtable and the other shows we got on the channel, like Rush Deep Dive and Stick It Out. Don't forget to like the video and share it. Once again, comment down below your thoughts. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you on the next episode. Later.